So thank you for joining me here tonight. Something that many of you may not know, but it's important to me, why I'm here at William & Mary. You're about to hear about this story of medical research that I took part in at Harvard Medical School. So with that, why would I be here at William & Mary and not up there at Harvard? And that's a kind of a cool thing, why that is. First of all, I am a very strong believer in the importance of public education and the delivery of therapy and assistance to people with challenges and disabilities at public expense. I believe that that is a foundation of building a great nation. And having served on advisory boards for a number of Harvard's institutions, I've consistently made that point of view clear, that it's great to develop therapies that are life-changing and transformational, but they don't have any practical value if they are only available to people who can pay $75,000 a year for them in private school. For us to make a change in America, it's got to be a change that starts in elementary public school, continues in public high school, moves into community college, and then institutions like William & Mary, the University of Virginia, the Virginia Medical College. It's the job of the state to prepare young people to go out and work, whatever that takes. Now, that brings me to the next really significant point, and that is, what are people like me doing in a college like this? We have some number of proudly autistic students here at William & Mary, and they form the nucleus of our student neurodiversity group. But there are a great many young people who would have liked to be William & Mary students. They might have even dreamed of being in William & Mary students, but they could not complete the requirements to get out of high school, let alone into an institution like this. And I know that because I'm one of them. I flunked out of school in the ninth grade. And you know, I am probably now the only person, and if there's any other exceptions, you can probably count them on one hand, that are teaching credit courses in a major university in the United States with no actual academic credentials. So you might on the one hand think, what a great achievement it is that I'm doing that. But I don't see it that way. The way I see it, I say, how many other people like me are out there that could be doing this job, that could be teaching young people, standing as role models, and yet they are excluded because they could not get the credentials to do this? The only reason that I am able to stand up here as a William & Mary faculty member is that I have had the great good fortune to have left home and done interesting stuff. I left home and joined a band, not because I thought it was cool to join a band, but because nobody would give me a legitimate job. And of course, when my band turned out to be hooked up with big sound companies, and the sound company was owned by Pink Floyd, and then Kiss came along and hired me, I did stuff that millions of people could relate to. And then, when I went and got a legitimate job, I went to a company that was making the first video games. And again, I did something that millions of people could relate to in designing video games. I didn't do that because I was so brilliant and smart. I did that because I was afraid of the drugs and craziness and rock and roll, and I wanted a legitimate job. And knowing that I couldn't qualify for a legitimate job with no education, I just misled those people at Milton Bradley about my qualifications, and they hired me. And you can't do that today. So what are we going to do for young people? And that's where William and Mary came on the scene. They invited me to come down here and speak some years ago. And I said to them at the time, did you know that I have a family connection to the school? And of course they didn't know. But in fact, my 8th grandfather was Roland Jones, who was the first minister to preach at the Bruton Parish Church here. Most people don't know this, but not only was he the preacher at Bruton Parish, he was the minister for the colonial capital in the 1670s and 80s, because he also held the pulpit in Jamestown. And his son, Orlando Jones, became one of the first students at this school at its chartering. And 4 years later, after Blair's teaching, he became one of the first American-trained people to teach at William and Mary. Those first four teachers were the original scholars in residence at this school. They were called that to separate them from the English masters. So today, I'm the scholar in residence in honor of my ancestor, who was the first one at this school. Now, I've been alive long enough to have seen 5 generations of autistic people in my family. My son's autistic. Obviously, I'm autistic. My son doesn't have any children, but that next generation in my family, we have autistic people. I have autistic cousins who do not talk, and I have autistic cousins who were just eccentric like me. One real tragedy is most of my autistic relatives that are my age, near 60, are dead today. And why is that? We don't know. We know that mortality is greater for autistic people. They died of various things. I don't know why, but it's a mystery. I look at my father and mother. My parents are both dead. And my father was quite obviously autistic in retrospect, but he died before we knew any of this. My grandmother and grandfather, and then my great uncles and great grandparents, and I see autism in all those generations. You know, my father grew up with a man who tended the pigs, and the man who tended the pigs was deaf and dumb, and you didn't talk to him. And you know what? My father never knew that that was his non-speaking and almost certainly autistic first cousin. There was such shame about autism in my parents' generation, they didn't even tell him it was his own cousin. He was just the deaf and dumb man that tended the pigs. So we've had autism for 5 generations that I can see. And if you follow that family tree, another 5 generations, you come to Roland and Orlando Jones. So when I look at that, and I look at the reality of the family in my living memory, and I ask, what's the likelihood that Roland and Orlando Jones were autistic? I don't know that we can ever know the answer to that question, but I think we can safely say it's a hell of a lot better than random chance. I can tell you that in addition to being my grandfather, these ancestors of mine were also the ancestors of Patrick Henry, who people speculate was autistic. Roland Jones was Martha Washington's grandfather, and they speculate about him. So it's quite possible that there was this thread of neurodiversity right back to the founding of the Virginia colony and the establishment of the United States. And we look at these ancestors of mine who were not just successful, they were great men in the establishment of Virginia and the establishment of this school. And my generation, we don't even qualify for admission. Even worse, we can't even graduate from a Virginia high school. So what do you believe is wrong there? Do you think that my generation got dumber, or do you think society changed to exclude us? Well, whatever you think, I'll tell you, I prefer to think society changed to exclude us. And so that is the reason that I'm here to speak at William and Mary. And Warrenetta here is the reason that I'm here to speak so strongly for autistic community. You know, Warrenetta and I grew up both in the South in the time of segregation. She grew up just after segregation came to an end. I grew up just before. Now I realize it's rude not for me to not point out that she's younger and fairer than me, you see. So I used to just say we grew up the same. And I said to her once when we had first met, and you saw her up here talking, you know, and she's all dressed stylishly, and she's like, well, she's like professional, you know. And I said to her, what's wrong with this picture? How is it that you're a black female, small, and I'm a great big white male, and yet you're the one with all the poise and self-assurance and confidence and educational credentials? Shouldn't it be the other way around? And you know what I learned from her? I learned from her that both of us heard hateful things about us when we were young. She heard hateful things about black people. I heard hateful things about retarded, stupid, and mental people, which was, of course, all me. But there was a vital difference. When Warrenetta heard that kind of stuff, she could go home and she could talk to her parents, and her parents could say, Warrenetta, what those people are saying are ugly lies. Our people are a great people. We have a proud history. We have leaders in our community. These are the people you can admire. We have leaders in all walks of life, and these are people you can admire. And we have leaders throughout history. And not only do we have that, we have a culture that goes back thousands of years. We have so much for you to be proud of. And she could be assured that they were lies, and she should stand proud. And she could do it, and she's where she is today. And what do you think my parents said to me when I got sent home from school for throwing a chair? Well, son, you come from a long line of kid biters and chair throwers. So nobody knew to say anything. And you know what? If I say to you, tell me who the black leaders are here. Tell me who the Jewish leaders are. Tell me who the Christian leaders are. Every one of you can answer that question. And if I say to you, outside of William and Mary, where we have our own student group that we're so proud of, if I say, show me the autistic leaders in Norfolk, show them to me in Jamestown, not a one of you can do that. And I think that's a real tragedy. And what it says to me is that we have a duty to come out of the closet and stand proud. We need people of my generation and many of you in this audience, we need other faculty at William and Mary to stand up and say, hey, I am autistic and I have been discriminated against as a child. I have felt disability, but I have also found gifts, and being autistic is part of what's made me successful. And we need those people to stand and be role models for our students here, just as our students are now stepping out to be role models for the people in the public schools in Jamestown and Hampton and other places that we've talked to people. Our students now are pen pals with autistic high school students in Hawaii. Isn't that something cool? And that's what we need to do. We need to stand up and we need to speak out, and we need to assert our rights. Think about the stuff that they say about autistic people in the news. You know that there was a killing and the gunman was autistic. And just imagine that if you substituted the words Jewish or black for autistic in that news story, and the reporter would be on the street in the morning. And yet they can say that with impunity about autistic people today. And it is up to us to change it. And that's one of the things that is so important to me. And for me, I learned the importance of that message from Warrenetta and from our students here in William and Mary. So before starting to talk about brain change, I just wanted to make you all aware of that. Maybe just think about that. Community is so vitally important. When your young people in your life, they come home and they're crying and they're sad and they're hurting, think of the power of autistic leadership and people that they can look up to. We need to build that here and all over the country. And that is one of my missions here at this school, to spread that knowledge. So you might wonder, with all that, and you've all, those of you who've read my earlier books, you know that I'm a strong believer in the value of autistic people. I absolutely recognize that autism brings us disability and exceptionality. I know that there are some autistic people who are primarily disabled, who cannot care for themselves independently. And I know that there are some autistic people who are brilliant and exceptional and care not only for themselves but for many other people. Autism spans this whole range of humanity. And having written on that and having spoken out about how we deserve accommodation as we are and we deserve respect in society, certainly I see no reason that my generation of autistic people should be any less respected than Roland or Orlando Jones. So why would I embark on a quest to do this brain stimulation thing and change myself if I believe that? That's something that a lot of people wonder. And you know, it was really, I think, a lot of it was learning how people had treated me as a child and how much that hurt me, and realizing that even though by 2008, when I started all this, I had become commercially successful. I owned a business, I had acquired a wife, and the wife had turned, and I had acquired another, which showed I was really skilled. And I had got myself a kid, Cubby. With all of that, I was keenly aware that I was on the outside looking in so many situations. I always knew that I'd see people talking and they'd just have this like intimacy and familiarity, and I could never quite do that. Also, I often had failed interactions. I operated a business where we are service for high-end automobiles. And people would come in, and I would say things to them that I still stand by today because I said the truth. I would tell people that they had damaged their cars and that they had done this and that, and they would say stupid things to me, and I would point out the stupidity of their words to them. And some of those people would be angry, and they would leave without employing us to fix their cars, despite the fact that I still maintain everything I said to them was correct and truthful. So I could see how, even though I was making a living, that thing, that social connection to people, that was a part of me that was disabled and it didn't work very well. I knew that my getting divorced was a thing that hadn't worked very well. So I had plenty of evidence in my life that that was something that I might want to change. And I had started to get invited to go out and speak about autism. And I was at a small school in Western Massachusetts. And this person walks up to me and she says that she's from Beth Israel Hospital in Boston and they're doing a study using magnetic brain stimulation to maybe improve emotional insight in autistic people. And she had no idea that that was like sort of at the center of my thoughts. Could I do that? Could I improve that somehow in me? And also, she had no way of knowing that her suggestion of magnetic brain stimulation, which I think she and many people thought of was kind of science fiction, was something that I was like immediately familiar with. Because when you go to a concert, the sound is all generated by firing large amounts of electricity into electromagnets with speaker cones connected to them that make the sound. And I did that with probably some of the biggest sound systems that have ever played. And then after I did that, I went to work for a company that made power conditioning equipment. And what we did there was we made power systems to deliver bolts of energy and also to absorb surges of energy. And it's interesting, what I did at that company is I designed the power conditioning equipment that sat at ground zero for our country's last underground nuclear tests. So those of you who have seen pictures of nuclear explosions from above ground tests back in the 50s, you see this like firestorm of lightning around the mushroom cloud, and the devices that I designed absorbed that energy so that the monitoring equipment could do its job until it was vaporized by the nuclear blast a short while later. I can tell you that because the Discovery Channel did a TV show on me a few years ago when they requested those files under the Freedom of Information Act, and the government gave them up, so now I can say it. So anyway, I did that by imagining those waves in my head. Because at that time, little companies didn't have access to big computers to run circuit simulations. And I did that by my imagination, the same way that I designed sound effects. And you know, people told me because I didn't have a degree, I wasn't a real engineer, and if the government knew that, they would prosecute me. And I left electronics because people told me I was a fraud. And you know, that's an example of how we can be crippled by autism in ways that you would never imagine. Those things that I designed, they stood the test of time. My devices for the government did their job. Everyone who listens to a video game today listens to sounds I created in the 1970s and 80s. All those classic rock and roll things that I did, millions and millions of people have listened to those things. So the work speaks for itself, and yet I abandoned all that because I believed I was a failure, and I believed I was a failure because I could not tell what people thought about me. And that is really the terrible power of social blindness to disable us. So some people have commented on my story and they've said Robeson must have just hated himself so much to do this. And no, I didn't hate myself, but I'm a practical guy. By 2008, I had come to realize what this particular aspect of disability had cost me. I never sought to cure my autism, and nobody ever presented brain stimulation as a cure for autism. I want to be really clear about that. What we hoped for was that we might affect this social blindness in me. And I understand, too, that there are other autistic people who do not feel socially blind. Not every autistic person is the same. But in these studies, I was one of 20-some people who all felt generally the same way, and we went into this with our eyes open. So that's why I would do it. The question was, what would happen? And so they told me that they were going to use electromagnets to fire pulses of energy into my head. I knew that the brain was a tangle of biological wires, so I knew electromagnetic pulses would induce tiny electrical signals, and I knew that the electromagnetic fields could be focused into small areas of the brain, and I understood, therefore, that they would be able to stimulate areas of my brain that were between the size of a marble and the size of a golf ball. It's funny, you know, sometimes people would say to me, you're crazy going into a study like that. You're fine the way you are. How can you even think of letting them rewire your brain? But I never had a second's hesitation. And maybe it was my, like, autistic engineer arrogance. I thought to myself, I probably know as much about the mechanics of the brain stimulator as they do. And I think that's probably true. I probably do know more about it than any of the doctors that used it. And I probably know more about it than most doctors that use it today. But I have a good friend, Dave Rifkin, who you'll meet in the book, who's a radiologist. And he said to me, yeah, well, you know a lot about it, and it's about as much help as a radiology technician that knows how to fix the x-ray machine has when he goes to set a broken leg. And I kind of like nodded at that, but it didn't really dissuade me. And so I went into the study, and they shot 1,000 images of my brain. And they made a 3D map of my head so that they could determine where they were going to target the TMS. This was before the TMS was approved for depression and all this stuff was being studied. And they decided what the targets would be. And they were going to stimulate them in weekly sessions, each of which would be half an hour long. And I went in for the first session. And what they had me do was sit down, and they showed me faces in front of a computer monitor. And I had to say if the faces were happy or sad. And they were very quick. They flashed by in a quarter of a second. And I had absolutely no idea. And I was very upset at the end of that. You know, I did this exercise, and I had no idea what any of them said. And I said that to the psychologist who was doing the test. And she said, "Oh, don't worry. There's no right answers in this. It's okay." And I said, "What kind of bullshit is that? Of course there's right answers. Nobody has a test without right answers." And she like didn't know what to say. But you know, I went on in and I did the stimulation. And it was the weirdest thing. I sat down in the chair, and they hold this coil up on your head, and they have a camera looking at you, and it's got like a really precise system to put the coil exactly where they want it. And then they step on a button and the thing starts going. And it goes click, 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 once a second. And you feel this like sort of, well, I mean, if you've ever stuck your finger in an electrical outlet, but just briefly, it's sort of like that. You feel this pop in your head. But it's not like getting continuously zapped because it just lasts for 1/1000th of a second. It's very, very brief. Most of you probably have not been zapped by pulses like that. But in addition to my work with the government on that, another thing I did is I led a group at a military laser company, and we made pulse power supplies for lasers that could vaporize crucibles of uranium and do other classified stuff. And those were also very powerful indeed, far more powerful than anything they use in a TMS lab. So I had this firsthand experience with getting zapped by pulses. And I recognized that. And the thing that was really weird was I was sitting there thinking, like, what's this going to be like? And what's going to happen? What will happen next? And my mind just like went blank. So I'd sit there for like 5 seconds, and I'd say, "I'm going to count pulses." And I would count 1, 2, 3, and then my mind would go blank. It was like the TMS put my mind in neutral. It was the strangest thing, you know. It was really, really weird. And then I'm sitting there, and just like, it stops. The pulses stop, and the cooling fan goes off. Half an hour had gone by, and it's like I hadn't even noticed. And they say, "Quick, come on, you know, we got to do the tests again." And they hustle me over to the computer and they have me do the tests. And I didn't have any idea if they were any different. So then they have a neurologist. He's got to examine me to make sure I'm fit to go home because I live 2 hours away. And the neurologist comes in and he starts off with his questions, you know, and he says, "What day is it?" I said, "It's Tuesday, of course." And he like looks at me and he keeps looking. I said, "What's the matter?" And he said, "It's Thursday." And I said, "Well, I don't pay a lot of attention to dates. You know, I'm self-employed. I probably just forgot." And he's still looking at me, and I realize, you know, I could be headed to a cage in the basement if I don't get this right. And so anyway, he keeps going with his questions, and fortunately, he decides to let me go. And I go down to the garage, and I get in my car, and I start to drive home. And I feel at that point like I've been at the hospital for 4 or 5 hours, and they've done all this stuff to me, and nothing's different. And I thought, what kind of a stupid fool was I? You know, I signed up for this thing, and I go, and I think they're going to zap me, and all of a sudden, I'm going to be different. And I'm the same person I was when I came out here. And I just thought, You know, I said I would do it and I'm going to follow through, but I was a dummy about this thing. And so I always would play music. Back then I played it on my iPhone, you know, now it's played on the, or iPod rather, before the iPhone. And I had bootleg recordings that I'd made back in the 70s and 80s of bands I did sound with. And so I put on this band, Tavares. Now Tavares is probably mostly unknown today, but they sang a lot of soundtrack for the movie Saturday Night Fever. It was a huge thing in the 70s. And I turned that on, and I was back in a nightclub in Boston in 1977. It was just stunning. It was like I'm listening to that music. I could like almost smell the cigarette smoke in the air, you know, being back there. It was so alive and vivid and real, and it made me cry. And I cried all the way home listening to that old music, not because I was sad, but because the feeling of the music was so overpowering. And you know, those of you who've read Look Me in the Eye, you might recall that I said in that book that I taught myself to see into music and to see waveforms, and that work I told you about I did for sound and the government and other people, that was all examples of that. And I taught myself to stand out in the audience, and if I wanted to listen to just the kick drum or the bass guitar, I could just listen to it with my mind and I could adjust it. And I always assumed every good recording engineer could do everything I could do but better. I never realized that was an autistic gift that few people could do. And I said in Look Me in the Eye that kind of faded away after I left music. But I thought it was a good trade because I could make friends with people, and I had a wife and kids and friends that I never had when I was younger. Because when I was doing rock and roll, I was like a mad scientist. You know, people did respect me, but I didn't really have friends. And it all came back on with that stimulation. And it was just like magic. And I wrote Alvaro, the scientist who led it, and I asked him how that happened. And he said he didn't know. And I realized that, you know, as cool as I thought it was to be like patient zero in this study, because they had never tried this kind of protocol on a human before. They had formulated these ideas about where the stimulations might be effective with cats and dogs and monkeys, and they'd never tried this on a person. And I realized that what we were doing was, you know, essentially throwing darts at a bunch of possible targets and see if anyone was a hit. And after that stimulation, I began to see feeling in places I hadn't seen it before. And that's a really interesting thing, because some people have looked at the title of the book and write-ups in the newspapers to think that this is a book about turning on emotion, and it's not. Autistic people, and this has been shown in a number of studies, tend to feel things more powerfully, more deeply, and for longer periods of time than people who are not autistic. So there is solid scientific evidence that says, for example, if I get divorced or my father dies or, you know, something like that happens, I will be more distressed than a non-autistic person, and that distress will last longer. Even though most of the time you would not be able to look at me and see that there was anything going on. That's a very, very curious thing, but it's true, and I learned that in the study. So I always had strong feelings. What I did not have was strong emotional reactions to things that weren't of direct importance to me. When my father crashed his car years before this TMS study, I was terrified that he was going to die. And I raced to the hospital. I was so worried. No child could have been more worried than me about his dad. But you know, at the same time, I could pick up a newspaper and I could read about people killed in a bus crash in Peru. And somebody next to me might be all crying and wailing, oh, that's horrible, horrible, there were children killed on that bus. And I would think, you're just making a play for attention. You don't care about these people in Peru. And I would I would think that, how could you care about that? You don't know them. And of course, that's a very pragmatic point of view. I had no response to those things. Well, suddenly, after that stimulation, the newspapers could make me cry. It was shocking. And like I said, I was fully familiar with the emotion, but I didn't, and never in my life had it triggered by things like that. So we kept doing the stimulations, and most of the stimulations, there were probably 30 of them, over a period of a few years, didn't do anything, but four of them were like life-changing. One of those stimulations turned on the ability to look in your eyes, and it was like looking into your soul. I could just like read your mind. Now, you can say how much of that's true and how much is an exaggeration, because in fact, I cannot know how my ability to look in your eyes and read your thoughts differs from an ability you may have had all your life to look in my eyes and read what I'm thinking. What Alvaro said about that was kind of interesting. He said that I had lived my whole life blind to the unspoken social cues of other people, and when I became aware that there was this thing I was missing, being a fairly bright guy, I used my logical brain power to look at what I saw and analyze it consciously to figure out what I was seeing. And he said, when the TMS turned on that stream of emotional data, and you also were using this logical processor in your mind to make sense of it, it may well have been like ESP compared to another person. But, he said, there's really no way to know, to get inside your mind and someone else's mind. What we could say is that it was totally overwhelming and devastating for me. I had this idea that I was going to go into this because I wanted to remediate a disability that had held me back. And I think I've described to you some pretty definitive ways that disability hurt me in my life. And it wasn't because I hated myself, it wasn't because of any of that. But I had constructed this fantasy, if you will. I had said to myself, I can pick up all the critical messages. Somebody says, oh, you're no good, you're a liar, or you're whatever. I could get that right away. But we've all heard, like our parents or our friends, say, oh, we love you and you're so great and we really admire what you're doing. And you know, I'd hear those kinds of things and they didn't make me feel good. But the stuff people would say, like, you know, you're just no good at all, that would make me feel bad. So I built this fantasy in my mind that was my problem. That because I was blind to these signals, there was this world of beauty and light and happy messages, and if only I could receive them, I would be happy too. And it's sort of like thinking what a fool I was when I got in a car before I turned on the music. So after they turn on this emotion in me, and I guess I said it wrong, right? They didn't turn on the emotion, but they turned on the emotional sensitivity and reaction. And I got to just be really clear about that because it means a lot to us autistic people. The emotions I saw, they weren't sweetness and light. They were angst and jealousy and fear and worry. And I realized that this was a foolish delusion that I'd had. And what had happened is I had opened up the floodgates for me to receive all the bad news of the world. And you know, I had sailed through several pretty good economic collapses in the area where I lived, and people came in and they told me all kinds of bad stuff. Bankers came in with cars they repossessed from my customers and asked me to sell them, and customers told me they were getting divorced because of the economy, and they were taking their kids out of private school because they couldn't afford it, and they told me all kinds of stories of pain and suffering. And I just I sat there and I said, well, you know, today we got to focus on the water pump, you know. And that's what I did. And I sailed through all of those recessions basically unaffected. And I thought back on when I started doing rock and roll. You guys that have read my books, you read about me playing in stadiums and arenas, but before I played in stadiums, I played in bars, and a lot of the bars I played in were biker bars. And I'd sit in those places, and these bikers would tell me all these stories, you know, oh yeah, they got in a tussle with this guy, and he broke his fingers, and they broke his kneecaps, and I fed him a TV dinner, tray and all, and they sent me to Walpole State Prison, and I'd feed it to him again in a minute if I saw the son of a bitch, you know, and they'd tell me stuff like that, and I would just listen to them, and I wouldn't react at all. And I realized that there I was. I was this autistic guy, and nothing people said really brought out any emotion. I didn't know any of those people. I didn't care if they fed them TV dinners or shot them and cut them into little pieces. I just listened. And I displayed no reaction. And these bikers looked at me, and of course I wasn't aggressive. I wasn't looking to start a fight. And they interpreted that as that's one hard son of a bitch. And I'm not going to get into a fight with him. And all of a sudden, that protection was gone. With this change, I was like devastated. The newspaper made me cry. I had to go outside and take breaks talking to customers. And what I thought would be this wonderful thing, it was, in the immediate aftermath of getting it, it was frankly crippling. And there was a lot of up and down. I came home and my wife said, "You won't need me anymore. You can see into other people now." And you know, as it happened, we ended up getting divorced. And it was one of the saddest things in my life. And you know, one of the other things that was really, really sad was looking at people that I thought were my friends and the stuff that they were laughing about and saying and realizing they were laughing at me. And of course, they aren't my friends anymore, some of those people. And that was really, really sad. There was a lot that was really sad about that. But you know what else it did? It made it possible for me to be here to talk to you today. Because after doing that TMS, I told you I was getting invited to speak places. I got invited to speak at this conference on autism research in Canada. And of course, you know, being uncivilized and uneducated, I had no real idea, you know. But I went up there and now I'm like dressed nicely, I got me a tie and stuff. That's because I got me a wife who has me trained. But this was before that. And I go up there, you know, in my old cargo shorts and my orange polo shirt, you know, and all these guys are respectable and they're dressed in suits and stuff, and the person at the conference, she says, "I'm sorry to put you on at 4:00 because you're going to have to wake up everyone after a long day of boring papers." And I still wasn't sure what I was going to say to them, you know, and this is in Toronto, and I get up and I said, "Well, folks, the last time I was here in your city, I came here in a Mercedes-Benz truck, and I can still remember it was a red Mercedes truck with an 18-foot box on the back, and I drove it up to the border station, and a Canadian customs guy, he comes around, and I roll down the window, and he asks me for my papers, and I reached over, and I opened the glove compartment, and right in there's a pound of Coke and a .38 revolver." And so I shut the glove compartment, and I said, "Excuse me a minute," and climbed out of the truck. And I said, "And that's an example how autism is a gift, because if I hadn't have been autistic, I would have freaked out and I would have been arrested and I wouldn't be here to talk to you now." So anyhow, after the talk, these guys come up to me in suits, and this guy, he introduces himself to me and he says he's the head of the Canadian National Institutes of Health and this is the premier, and they want to talk to me about my talk. And then this other guy, he comes up to me and he says, he's the head of the U.S. National Institutes of Health. And these are his colleagues here who head the National Institutes of Children's Health and the National Institutes of Mental Health. And I'm thinking, I told these guys all about smuggling Coke into Canada. But the thing is, it wasn't my Coke. I was only driving a truck. And that was the point of the story, you know, that I just had no reactions. It wasn't my truck. It wasn't my drugs or anything. But anyway, he says, would I consider getting more involved in government service? And then one of the fellows, he says, his name's Alan Guttmacher. And of course, I didn't have any idea who he is. And he tells me he's the head of the National Institutes of Children's Health. And I asked him how come he was interested in autism. I said, are you autistic? And he said, no, he wasn't autistic. But he said he'd been around autism all his life. And he asked me if I, you know, knew who Leo Kanner was, who published a paper on autism in 1943 that kind of defined autism as we know it today. And he said, Leo Kanner was my grandfather, was my godfather. He said, my parents were scientists who met in Kanner's lab at Hopkins. And I grew up playing in his house. And he said, that's why I'm interested in autism, because I learned about it from him and I've been around it all my life. And you know, those guys took me in. And they advised me, and they set me on the road that led me to William and Mary, where Warren Etta here told me stories of her own childhood and helped me to understand why we need this community. They helped me see why we need autistic people involved in research. It's funny, they told me that when they asked me to get involved in that. And it's funny, they said, yeah, you can get up and say things that we think should be said, but we can't say them. Clearly I demonstrated the ability to do that. So anyway, that was all made possible by TMS. Not because TMS gave me all those abilities, but what TMS did is it turned on this ability to see into other people so that in those initial moments when I meet somebody, I can say a correct enough series of things that they don't say, he's a jerk, and turn away. And if you think, well, what would be the evidence of that? I had all these performance reviews when I worked in industry, and I had a long line of people that I worked for in music who said that I was a loner, a freak, I was a smart guy, but I was not a team player. And of course, I remember telling people that I designed better circuits than theirs when I was 14 years old and stuff. I know that I did those things. So I was like a total failure in terms of being in committees and teams and groups. And what happened? After TMS, I get involved in the most bureaucratic tangle of them all, the U.S. government. And not only did I do that, when I started that, people kind of made fun of me. They say, you're just a token autistic person. Nobody's gonna care about that. But it hasn't been true. You know, I've been repeatedly reappointed, and not only am I reappointed, people say I'm a unifying force that brings them together. That is the most remarkable thing for someone to say about me, who all my life was not a team player, an outcast, unable to connect with other people. And I look at that and I think, what changed? The year all of that started to happen was the year after TMS. And you know something else that's really interesting? I didn't even tell you about this, but I had kind of another career in photography. When I left music as an engineer, I took up photographing musicians. So a lot of these rock and roll people I did engineering for, now I shoot images off them, and I also photograph circus performers and carnival performers. And my images are actually quite widely distributed, but nobody knows because I don't have my name on the pictures as I do on the spine of a book. And what's interesting is I took commercially successful, realistic, accurate pictures of those performers in all the years before TMS. In the year after TMS, my picture-taking style changed dramatically. I went from taking realistic pictures to taking what became almost abstract expressions with brilliant, oversaturated colors, really sharply defined edges, much simpler compositions. The pictures became strikingly different. Not only did they become different, they became far less real than what I had been taking before. And you know what happened? People who look at the pictures said, that's exactly like I remember it. So they would look at these pictures and all you see is like the guy's hand on a guitar or the guy's face or something, and they would say, that's just like I remember it. And it's not like you remember it. You were 200 feet back in the audience and you saw a bunch of little tiny figures on a stage. You didn't see that at all. But that's what people remember. It's the most remarkable thing. The pictures are so transformed and they connect with people in a way that they never did before. And so I look at that and I think, I could have changed the way I developed pictures at any time in my photographic career. Why did I choose to do it the summer I did the TMS experiments? And you know, I ask that and nobody knows why. When we started those experiments, the thought was that these stimulations might have an effect that would last a few hours to a few days. And while I cannot see into your souls with that power I had before, that's gone. That definitely faded away. My ability to engage you, to be up here, to be animated is so dramatically different. And you know, it's still here 6 years later. So we've got folks here from the medical college, from East Virginia Medical School, and they're doing TMS for depression and anxiety now. And they're seeing the same thing. People are coming in and they're getting TMS treatments for depression and anxiety, and they're walking out of there fixed. And how do you compare that to people who are going in and starting on a lifetime of psychiatric medication? So people have dismissed this idea of electromagnetic brain stimulation as science fiction. But you know, me and those people walking out of the clinic at the medical school, we're here to tell you it's real. And my story is a story of an autistic guy whose life was transformed. And I had some serious downs, but I've got some major ups. Certainly my autism advocacy, I think it's the greatest thing I've ever done. And I believe that TMS played a significant role in giving me the ability to stand before you and do that. And I think that's a really, really important thing in my life. And as high as the personal cost has been, I think that makes it worth it for me. But when you think about this, think of the idea that I'm an autistic guy who was so transformed by these experimental treatments, and consider that TMS is now being studied. They're studying it at the medical college for social anxiety. They're using it for anxiety and depression. They're studying this now to suppress seizures and epilepsy. That's something that kills people. And we may have in our hands a tool to stop it in its tracks. There is actually now a TMS therapy in review at the FDA to relieve some symptoms of intellectual disability. Do you realize what that means? Relieving symptoms of intellectual disability is another word for making people smarter. And think about what they did with me. Turning on those responses in me, that is truly improving my social intelligence. So for the first time in the history of medicine, scientists are going after previously unattainable goals. And it's not just a story about autism, it's a story about a technology that I think is going to change lives for many, many people. But it's a scary thing. It's a time for a new world. Are we out of time here?
Well, I want to make sure that you get a chance to answer some questions.
All right.
Because I know people have
see that?
For you. So I definitely want to say thank you to John. And I'm grateful for the both challenges and the gifts that come with John's autism, because it brought us the remarkable person that he is. And I want to give you all the opportunity to thank you for this as well.
So thank you. So we do have time for questions, right? Okay, so this is only the second time that I have talked about this TMS experience in my new Switched On book. So I guess if you want to know what happened next in the book and how I got from there to here, They've got my books out there. If you want to know the story of raising my son, I got Raising Cubby, and some of you are parents, and in Raising Cubby, you will find some essential truths of parenting, the real story behind Santa, the truth behind Easter bunnies, things that no one but me would tell you. And of course, they got Look Me in the Eye, and they got Be Different. So I guess that's what it is. So, which of you has questions about autism, TMS, or whatever? Yes?
Thank you for the presentation. I have two questions. One of them is, I don't know how far this university goes. I want to discourage you have any investment in TMS.
So he's asked me if I have any investment in TMS. So there's two answers I'm going to give you. One is simple. No, I do not. I do not have any support from any institution involved in doing TMS research treatment. I do not have any support from any medical institution at all. But I want to go farther than that. Because of my success in being able to talk to people, I told you I've been invited to serve on government committees. Today, I serve on what's called the Interagency Autism Committee, which is the top-level autism committee for the U.S. government. I report to the Secretary of Health and Human Service and the Congress. I am a special federal employee. We produce the strategic plan for the U.S. government, which guides the CDC, the NIH, the Department of Education, and other government agencies. I also serve as one of two American representatives on the ICF CoreSet Steering Committee for Autism for the World Health Organization. Because I serve on those government groups, I can have no affiliation with any industry that's involved in autism. The only affiliation I can have is what I have here, which is that I teach and I speak about autism at this university and others. I am in no way involved in selling or promoting this other than as something that I believe in. I have absolutely no conflict like that at all.
My son is identified as autism, and we want to psychotherapist push neurofeedback, try for 6 months. So what do you think of neurofeedback?
So he's asked, he said that he's tried neurofeedback with his son, and what is the difference between neurofeedback and TMS? The difference is that neurofeedback is a system where brainwave monitors are connected to your head, and you do exercises, usually on a computer screen, and the changes in your brain activity in response to what you see and do on the screen can help you get into, say, a state of calmness or whatever. I mean, you can use neurofeedback to optimize your state of mind, if you will. TMS is fundamentally different because TMS puts energy into your head and it actually can change what you can see. Let me give you an example, okay, of being colorblind. If you're colorblind, all you see is black and white. And so you live your life and people say, oh, it's a pretty red shirt, pretty green grass, and blue sky. And eventually, you start to think, these people are just putting me on. They're just baiting me. I know the evidence in my eyes. It's all shades of gray. It's no such thing, right? You can see how that would happen if you were a colorblind guy. And you eventually become angry at what is other people's stated reality. So then imagine you go into a lab and the scientists turn on color vision in you for a week. And then it fades away. But you know what? You will never be the same. Because for the rest of your life, you are going to know that what those people said to you is true. And whenever somebody says, that's a beautiful blue sky, you're going to look up and you're going to know what beautiful blue sky means, even if you can't see it. And you're going to know those people aren't putting you on. And because you know that they're not tricking you, you're going to conduct your affairs differently. TMS is a tool that can switch on something like that in you. Neurofeedback is a tool that can help you optimize what you've already got. Now, I understand that there's people that do neurofeedback services that will object to what I say, but the fact is TMS is a powerful therapeutic treatment tool that is administered by doctors in a hospital setting. Neurofeedback is more of a passive self-adapting tool. So it's really a kind of a fundamental thing. Now, having said that, I want to stress that there is not presently an autism therapy that you can go seek out with TMS. And I also want to make clear that there is no such thing as a generalized autism therapy. The thing that I took part in at the Harvard TMS lab was aimed at turning on the ability to read unspoken cues in other people. The folks at East Virginia Medical School right now are running a TMS study where they are looking at remediating social anxiety in autistic people. There are other people who are doing studies that are looking at reducing other specific things that disable us autistic people. None of those are studies to cure or remove or treat autism in a general sense. They're aimed at specific things that disable us. So, if your son, for example, is suffering from social anxiety and autism, the folks at the Virginia Medical School would be people to talk to. If your son has a problem with executive function and organization, there are people studying that elsewhere in the country. And I think what you're going to find is in the next 5 to 10 years, you're going to find that these therapies are much more broadly deployed, and you will be able to get these kinds of treatments. And the other thing, how old is your son? 19? Okay. So at 19, your son is old enough to be an adult and to explain what he's getting into. And another thing that we have to be really conscious of here is that TMS is potentially one of the most powerful transformative tools neuroscience has ever seen. And with that, we have to be very, very conscious of our ethical responsibility to young people. So you may be very tempted, for example, to say, my 5-year-old son comes home crying every day because he has no friends. He's in such pain because he's autistic and he can't make friends. And they might make that leap, and then it would be very easy to say, could I get TMS for my son to turn on that thing like you describe? And I think that's a very, very dangerous thing to do on really young people. So I would be very cautious of that. So, yes, you have, oh boy, it's all you at once with questions. Okay, you in the middle first then.
Any particular part of the brain that TMS targets when you're getting a treatment?
Yes, he's asked if there's any part of the brain that TMS targets. TMS can reach about an inch into the brain, but a great portion of the thought processes are actually located in that outer layer of the brain, the cortex. So TMS can reach any part of the cortex. It can be here, here, like in the back here, it would affect vision. It could be delivered anywhere to the outer surface of the brain, except the bottom from underneath. It can't get under there. And there are other technologies that are under study that can reach deeper. So it can go all around. So we had another question there, yeah?
You mentioned the studies underway on executive function, for example. Is there a sort of authoritative, credible website or institution we can go to learn about the different studies in different places?
I'm going to be doing a presentation on TMS to the Interagency Autism Coordinating Committee, and we're going to have some discussion of that in our federal government committee. Our website is iacc.hhs.gov. That's IAC, Health and Human Services, U.S. Government. Everything on our website is free and open to the public, and you can actually watch all the transactions on webcast. They're archived and you can see them. We're going to have that talk, which will be a discussion in our government committee, which I would say I'd like to think is trustworthy. I mean, there are medical people, not politicians running for office. And we also, There are a great many articles published on TMS. So we have a government website called PubMed, P-U-B-M-E-D. You can go to PubMed and you could put in for search terms, for example, TMS autism, and that would show you abstracts on every article published in a legitimate medical journal anywhere in the world. That's curated, again, by the U.S. National Institutes of Health. And if you wanted to read those articles, there's two methods of that. You could go, say, to the medical school here. You could go to William and Mary. You could read them in our libraries because we have academic access. If you wanted to be able to just paw through them to your heart's content by yourself, the U.S. National Library of Medicine is adjacent to the National Institutes of Health in Bethesda. You can drive up there and read them all. Yes?
When you described your visualizing of sound waves, was that a learned behavior or was that an inherent thing that you already had? Because to me, it sounded like you were describing a form of synesthesia. And especially when that was enhanced when you participated in the stimulation. And so is it possible that you had a form of synesthesia, which is a unique neural connection, and that was brought out by the study? And if I'm completely wrong, have any other synesthetes participated?
No, you're not wrong about that. That's a funny thing, you know. My participation in some of these medical studies have shown me disabilities I didn't know I had. And one of them is synesthesia. Another one is face blindness. You know, they showed me at Sapienza University in Rome that if you take a picture of my son, a photograph of my son, and you render it as a line drawing and put it in a lineup with five other guys about my son's age, I can't pick my own kid out. And with synesthesia, that's, again, it's something that I assumed that every good sound engineer could just see it and do it better than me. And what's funny about that is the reason I thought that is that so many musicians talked to me about music and colors. And I now realize that a great many musicians have synesthesia. But we are all different in that way, and it's kind of sad, actually, that synesthesia is described in the medical literature as a kind of a form of brokenness. And for us, it's really not a brokenness at all. I had that ability naturally, but the ability to multiply waves in my head, which is the ability to do rough calculus in my head, that is something I trained myself to do with many, many hours of practice, looking at oscilloscope waveforms, listening to sounds, and adding and changing them. So, yes?
Did you say that other people did the same experiment at the same time that you did at Harvard?
I did, and when you read Switched On, you're going to meet a number of other participants, and you're going to see some similarities and some differences with my experience. And something else that's really interesting that's come out since I wrote the book, because I actually wrote the words to the book 2 years ago, and this is just how long it's taken to publish it and stuff like that. But in the last couple of years, we've seen a bunch of internet forums spring up where they talk about TMS for depression, because now there's 1,000 places doing TMS for depression in the United States. And you know, you can take anything that you read in Switched On, and you might think, that is some far out stuff he writes about there. And you will find that same far out stuff described happening to people in those depression forums. Like I told you how I cried and how the music overwhelmed me. There are a number of accounts of essentially that same thing happening totally out of the blue to depression patients. It's really kind of remarkable. Yeah?
Part B. The doctors who administer this test, or the treatment, what would they put on a consent form as far as side effects? Or what kind of things would they mention?
The side effects that were known when I went into the study was that there was a slight risk of epileptic seizure. There was a more realistic risk of headache. There was a risk of ear discomfort. There was some physical discomfort risks. there were not really at that time any known psychiatric risks. When you read what happened to me over the ups and downs, which were pretty significant in my life after that, you might ask yourself, how did the hospital let that happen? And the answer is that we went into this with our eyes open with the best available medical knowledge of the time. And if you entered into a TMS study at Harvard Medical School today, some of the disclosures would be very different, due in large part to the experiences in these studies. It's necessary to move medical science forward for us to use our best knowledge. And I absolutely stand behind the people at Harvard Medical School. I believe they did the very best they could. They disclosed everything to me. When I asked for support, I got it unstintingly. I absolutely believe in what they did. But I also recognize that there are things in research into the mind that are unknowable until we do them. Yeah?
As part of your participation in different government organizations, what are your policy priorities for autism in the United States?
She's asked what my priorities are for autism research in the United States. The first thing that I would say, I gave you the example, right, of what happens when autistic people get into trouble, and it's in the news, right, and how that would never be said about other minority groups in the United States. The autistic population of America is very similar in size to the Jewish population in this country. When we ask what we're going to do to address a problem in the Jewish community, who do we turn to? We turn to the rabbis and the Jewish community leaders. Not only do we do that, but it is absolutely unthinkable that we would ask anyone to formulate Jewish policy other than Jewish leaders. Wouldn't you say that's a well-recognized thing now? So why is it that we even presume to ask the question for autistics? It's crazy. What do we think? Other people have the right to choose our destiny. If there is one message that people hear from me consistently in the U.S. government and in every organization that funds autism research and institutions that ask my opinion and even institutions that think I should keep my mouth shut, they hear that this is our deal, folks. The only reason that we do not have autistic people sitting at the chair of every committee involved in governing autism research, therapy, and services is that we have not grown the community to deliver the people. And as we deliver the people, it is our right to take charge of our destiny. It's our deal. So that is the overriding message. The second message is that we have spent far too much money chasing this down the rabbit hole of genetics and eugenics. And what are we going to do to find the autism gene? And you know what? That doesn't matter one little bit to me or any of the rest of you who are living with autism today. What matters today is that we deliver services to deliver the maximum quality of life to autistic people who are living today, and that we respect and welcome the autistic people who will be born tomorrow. It's absolutely fine for us to look at genetic research with a view to helping autistic people. It is morally wrong to do so with a view to eliminating autistic people. And we have to always keep in mind that genetics is going to take a back seat to so many other accommodations to help us in life. And we have a tremendously diverse array of needs. I felt, for example, that I was socially disabled and held back in relationships. Other autistic people can't talk and need assistance to communicate. Other autistic people have terrible intestinal distress and they need relief from that. Autistic people have epileptic seizures. We have 100 different things that we need help for, and you know what? We've done almost nothing to materially improve the lives of autistic people in the last decade. And I say that that is fundamentally wrong. So when you ask what I speak up for in government, that is what I speak up for. So I hope that I've answered you positively. Yes.
Thank you.
Yep.
Support for special needs students, 5 years old, adults, and other disabilities. When I read your book with me in the eye, I can tell you that it changed my life forever. And the way it gave me the ability to see inside the mind of a child with autism and what they may be trying to communicate and what they understand what we communicate to them. So that book was the best thing that could have ever been written to help someone understand the mind of a child with autism.
Mm-hmm.
And what they say and do and the reasons they have to have to interpret what they're thinking in the non-communicative and things like that. The other thing I'd like to ask you is with the TMS, we're talking about your emotions and how they change. If this had been done with you, say when Cubby was young, with the change in your emotions, do you think things would have been different? Would you have seen any difference, do you think, in parenting or relationship, your personal relationship, like with your wife? Did it change emotionally for you? Or has it been done many years ago? Did you have seen it?
So I don't know if you could hear that. She asked a sort of a complicated question about me and Cubby and how it would have changed. Cubby was 18 when I started the TMS studies, and Cubby actually did the studies with me. And I think doing the studies changed Cubby like it changed me, and it brought us closer together. As for being a better parent, one of the greatest parenting tools that I discovered when Cubby was little was these things called Oshkosh coveralls. Do all of you know those? Like the blue jeans with the suspender straps? And the thing that is good about them is they have a lifting hook on the back so that you can pick the Cubby up and you can get him safely at arm's length so he can't bite you and you can give him advice. And I gave Cubby a great deal of advice, and like most fathers, I believe I'm responsible for every worthwhile skill my son has today. And so I cannot really know if I would have been a better parent with TMS. I mean, that is one of those, it's one of those unknowable things. But I at least do tell the story of my son in raising Cubby. And I got to thank all of you so much for joining me here and listening to this tonight. And I'll be out here to sign books and answer questions if you want to ask me outside. So thank you so much.